We're sitting in the foundation lounge of the State Library of Victoria, just off the Dome Reading Room, and we're here with Dr Bostjan Zeks, the Minister for Slovenes Abroad. Dr Zeks, welcome.
Hello.
Dr Zeks, is this your first trip to Australia?
Yeah, this is my first trip. Yeah. And I'm very, very happy I'm here. I'm here in the library, so I hope I will come again.
Good, we'd love you to. We'd like to talk to you about the Iconotheca Valvasoriana.
Yeah.
And I'd like to start by asking you about Valvasor the man. Could you give us a little bit of a pen portrait of this character?
Yeah, he lived in the second half of 17th century in a castle, which is now in the center of Slovenia. That region was called Krain in German or Carniola in Latin. And he was, polyglot, polyhistor. He knew everything what was known at that time.
And is he a very famous person in your history? Is he very
famous? Yeah, of course. He was the first really knowledgeable man. He understood natural sciences, technical sciences, biology, everything. He was dealing also with vampires, which is not his main occupation, but still it's one of his interests.
He'd be very popular nowadays with the Twilight series.
Yeah.
So, obviously, while he travelled a lot, and as he travelled, he collected great works of art and prints and all sorts of things. Can you tell us a bit about the collection?
Yeah, a collection is basically a collection from other authors, but a good part of the collection was produced by Valvasor and his people he employed. I like mostly his drawings of animals, flowers, such things. And among the other part of the collections which was really collected, there are some graphic works. There are some works of Durer, which are not known in Europe. These are single pieces.
So there are unique pieces.
These are unique pieces in Europe. Oh. Yeah.
And I have this in my imagination. I can see coaches traveling along with artists and archivists and all sorts of people in there.
Yeah, I would say the basis of his work was in one of his castles. Well, he was employing a number of people who were drawing, painting, and so on.
Right. And the collection, it grew to 17 volumes.
Yeah.
Where are they now, the originals?
You know, he spent all his fortune doing these things. Right? So at the end he was poor, he had to sell the castles, he had to sell this collection, but we are slightly ashamed of this. We didn't, in Slovenia, nobody wanted to buy this. Uh-huh. So fortunately the bishop from Zagreb, neighboring larger city, decided to buy the collection, which was good because the collection stayed together. Okay, they didn't sell it by pieces. Okay? So the collection is now in they call it Biblioteca Metropolitana, library of the Archbishop of Zagreb, and we somehow got the permission to make a copy of this collection there.
And the collection itself in Zagreb, how much would that be worth?
Oh, this is hard to say. It's very, very expensive. I would say it depends on the pieces. Some of them are the only copy in the world, so it's hard to decide. But I would say many millions of euros.
So it's virtually priceless because of the unique qualities of it. Yeah. Incredible. Have you seen the original?
Oh yeah, I was there. They have a special department, a special room for this collection. It's locked and not accessible. there is a man responsible for this. And it's conserved fairly well. Originally there were 18 volumes, but in the 19th century one of the volumes disappeared. So now there are 17.
So there is a lost volume somewhere.
Yeah, there is a lost volume somewhere.
And you say that obviously you've had a chance to see it. It sounds like a national treasure.
Yeah.
What's your favorite part of the work? What's your favorite volume?
It's difficult to say. I would say from just looking at these drawings, I like very much the drawings of flowers and such things. They are very colorful. Mm-hmm. But of course, as far as the art is considered, the others are more important, I would say, the graphics of Durer and other artists.
It was a very brave decision to say, let's turn these 17 volumes into a facsimile edition.
Yeah.
And I believe it took 10 years.
It took 10 years, to yeah. Yeah.
Where did the idea originally come from?
It's hard to say. It's basically idea of one single person. I don't know how it is here in a big country, but in a small country as we are, it depends only on one single person. And this man, Dr. Gostisha, got this idea, and he was strong enough to push it through all these formalities. At that time, I was the president of the Academy of Sciences and Arts of Slovenia, and my role was only to get some money from various sources, which was not so difficult as the whole work is.
Uh-huh. And Dr. Gostisha, how big was his team? Because this was a huge editing job, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's Dr. Gostisha is a special type of a character, I would say. Just one thing I would like to mention. He graduated almost 80 years old. He was doing this business all the time, but nobody asked him for a diploma or something like that. So when he was 80, he finally graduated. Some people are saying that he went to visit his late mother on the graveyard to show her the diploma, that he finally got this. But then after that, immediately he started with his PhD thesis, which is also nice, and after some 5 years he got his PhD degree.
He would go down very well in Australia. We do like our diplomas here as well. Can you tell me about what you imagine people will do with the facsimile edition? Researchers, what your hopes are for it?
Basically, there are two reasons why we did this. One is, I would say, it's internal. We would like to show that to our people, which sometimes believe that they are small, they cannot do anything, which is nonsense, of course, to show that they have history, they have people who can do something, Valvasor or Gostisha. So this is the internal part. The other part is that we would like to show the world that we are here, we are part of the world. We have a history which is similar to the history of other European countries. So we hope that when this collection will be in any of larger libraries, people will come, will look at this collection, will read the text, which is very carefully prepared, and will learn that we exist.
And you've given copies already to the Queen and the Royal Society in London. Where else do you intend to?
The idea is to give these collections to all bigger libraries. Right? So it's already in Vienna, in China. It is now at this expo exhibition, and other countries.
And why did you choose the State Library of Victoria in Australia?
Yeah, it's hard to say, but one, our wish was to go to Australia, to give one copy of this collection to one of the libraries in Australia. And then we somehow realized that here there is the biggest population of Slovenians which emigrated to Australia.
Yes.
And I believe that this will help also them to somehow have a better image and to be proud of their country.
There's certainly a very lively Slovenian community in Melbourne. I believe you have travelled widely, Europe, the Americas, Asia. Are you building your own collection?
Oh, no. It's... I'm a physicist. So, and I was not educated in such a way that I would make the collection. Then I was also a good part of my life. I was living in a system where private persons didn't make any collections.
I was wondering what your impression is of the State Library. You've had a short look around it. What's your feeling about the library?
It's impressive. You have seen two exhibitions, very the central part, and we are impressed. But half an hour is not enough, really, to say.
And hopefully you can have a look around a bit later.
Yeah.
I was reading an interview that you did with somebody else, and you said in that interview, good teachers and students also need an ambitious modern university library.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Could you give me a few words about university libraries and your feelings about libraries in general?
Libraries, of course, are important. But now, in these new times, the role of libraries is changing. I don't know how it is here, but in our university library in Ljubljana, Slovenia, the number of visitors is decreasing. But they have internet access to the library, and they are using it from home. Then it's also happening that various schools, for example, technical school, science schools, they have their own libraries. So somehow the system is disintegrating, which I don't like. So it's a question how to combine these new technologies and this fact that you need one combined library that covers everything. So I hope you are doing this here.
I think it's a struggle that happens all over the world, actually.
Yeah.
Understanding this. And my final question is, in Ljubljana, you've got the World Book Capital this year, and I wondered if you could just tell us a few of the activities that will be taking place.
Let me tell you this first. For us, books are essential. Books are extremely important. We, in our history, we never had political power, military power, anything like that, but we had books. For example, we got first Bible translated to Slovenian language 400 years before we got our own state independence. So the culture was really developing all the time, successfully, without any political independence in this. So the books for us are basis of our life. And therefore, in all these activities in this year of the book, what is amazing is that many people collaborate, many people take part in this. They are selling books, they are reading books, you can borrow the books on the street and go home and bring it back next week or something like that. It's this is the most important part, that we see that practically all the 2 million Slovenes are reading.
And what are the literacy rates in your country?
Oh, it's zero. So yeah. It's zero unless for some exceptions.
Thank you. That's excellent. Thank you for your time.